books as a lens to view American history. And the title of his talk is called Ripped from the Headlines. With no further ado, let's welcome to the stage. Let's go.
Give him a round of applause.
All right. Hey, thank you. Okay, all right. It's great to be back. I had an opportunity to present last year here. And so I was invited back by Gene, so I want to thank Gene wherever he is and everybody at the staff of Shortbox. And so I'm excited today to talk a little bit about kind of how comic books represent American history. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about kind of the genres of comics and move some different historical events and kind of do a little timeline here. But before we do that, I am Adam Rapp. I'm a professor at Ohio University, and I'm a passionate comic book collector. And so that's where this all stems from. Now, so when is a comic more than a comic? So when we think about this, obviously we know what comic books are, and many of us look at comic books for collecting or for entertainment purposes, but there's more to that. When we start thinking about comics and the role that they had in society and history, it goes much, much deeper than just simply a collectible, and that's what we're going to talk about today. Now, okay, so my story is this. I want to tell my origin story and why I'm so passionate about comic books. I come from Western Pennsylvania. I come from a small town called Oil City, PA. And so for me, born in the 1970s and growing up in the 70s, we didn't have a lot. There was not a lot of information that was easily accessible to us. So if you're like me, you might be familiar with this, the Wildlife Treasury Box. And that was something that many of us had in the 70s and 80s because we didn't have the internet. And so for us, we got a lot of our information through this, and it was a little plastic box that had picture cards, and on the back it had information about places and animals, and for us, that was the internet. And so for me, as a child, I studied this, and because I wanted to learn more about different places and different things. Now, the other source of information we had was the Encyclopedia Britannica. And so, growing up in the 1970s, almost every household or someone in your family had a set of Encyclopedia Britannicas. And so for me growing up, right, we had a set of Encyclopedia Britannica my grandparents had from 1952. Now being born in 74, reading this in the late 70s, this is the date and the age of the information that I had access to. Because again, without cable television, without the internet, right, we had to get information and knowledge from somewhere. And so for me, I would read these. And one interesting thing about it is there was a story about the atomic bomb. And it talked about what to do if an atomic bomb was dropped in your neighborhood. And it said, based on 1952 information, that you should hide on your desk and you should take a shower to wash off the radiation. And so we realized the dated information, the dated knowledge, right, wasn't that good. So there was another source to get information. It was comic books. So for me, right, growing up, what we would do is we would go to church on Sunday morning, we'd come back from church and we'd stop at the convenience store. And my father would let us go in and we'd grab a comic, and my brother and I each grab a comic. And if we could get one, by the time that he got to the counter for his lottery tickets and Sunday paper, then we were able to get one. And so for my brother and I, this was a source of information, a source of knowledge, that we would read these and study these, because for us, it became the great escape. And so for us, it was a chance to see different things in different places. And some were fantasy and some were reality, obviously. But it was a chance for us to go somewhere else and gain access to knowledge and information we didn't otherwise have. Now, sometimes it was fantasy like this, some of the first issues I was able to purchase. But then other times, right, there were story arcs. There were narratives that drew you in month after month when these issues came out. Now, some, like the Secret Wars, obviously, with the Beyonder, weren't real, they were fantasy. But the Spider-Man storyline, Gang War, was based in Hell's Kitchen, based in New York City. And so it gave you a snapshot of what it was like living there in the 70s and the 80s, and some of the violence and some of the different things. And so there was some history, there was some information, but it goes deeper than that. Now, for me, this is what really gave me my love for comics. And it's led me to a passion where I do my own fanzine, I do a different convention at my house. And so we know that comics have had a huge influence, right? We know that the reach is global. It's worldwide, from here to California, the US, and around the world. We know the influence that comics have had in the movies and pop culture, etc. So we know that there's a following. Now that gets us to today's conversation. Comic books and history, it's not an oxymoron. Now we know what an oxymoron is. It's this idea of two words that don't agree with each other. Jumbo shrimp, anarchy rules. So when I think comic books and history, some people say, comic books are for mere enjoyment, whereas realistically I see them as something more than that. And there's been a lot of history that's been demonstrated throughout time in comic books. So let's go ahead and do a walk through history and through time and talk about kind of this journey, if you will. Now we're gonna go way back. We're gonna start in the late 1800s. Okay? We're gonna start specifically 1890s. Now some of you may say, well, geez, 1890s, were comics really there yet? And yes, so The Yellow Kid is argued and debated to be one of the first comic books created back in the 1890s. Now, the reason that this is so relevant is two different reasons. First was what was happening in the printing world. So there was an individual named Richard Occult, who was an artist who drew for Edison, who actually came up with The Yellow Kid. But the reason he did that was because Joseph Pulitzer, you might know the name Pulitzer, owned the New York World newspaper, and he wanted to do something more. He wanted to start printing different colors because in the 1890s, printing press technology had really started to develop where we could start to print more colors. And so before, it was very drab, but they had the opportunity to print yellow. And so The Yellow Kid was an opportunity to print this yellow nightshirt so they could start to understand how to print colors. Now what was fascinating about it is the editor at the time, Goodard, there was two options. One option was to use color printing in women's fashion supplements. And Goodard said no. He said he wanted specifically to print something that would educate society. And so The Yellow Kid was born. Now, obviously, part of it was the printing press technology, but the other piece of it was the idea that you could communicate to the affluent and the wealthy what it was like being an immigrant in New York City in the 1890s. So what we see is Richard Occult would walk through the city, walk through a lot of the immigrant parts of town, like Little Italy and places like that, and he would see how people lived and what their lifestyles were like. And they used the comic strip in the Sunday paper, moving on to the comics, to actually talk about and portray the life of the immigrant to help educate those that were wealthy to some of the lifestyles of those people that had come over from other countries. Now, if we look at this, what we can see is this is a perfect example of one of these strips, one of the pages in the comic books that talks about life living in New York City as an immigrant. And it talks about the need for teachers, it talks about the Board of Education. And you can see in the top left, it talks about how they need teachers. And so all of a sudden, they were using this vehicle, they were using these comics to start to talk about the needs. Now, if we move forward, we start to look at this. A lot of us are familiar with Platinum Age comics and this idea of bringing a father and the Gumps from the 1900s. And it was a direct reflection of life at the time. So that's our grounding. So that's the founding of how comic books started to really replicate and demonstrate what was happening in the world. Now, if we move forward, we're gonna jump ahead to the 1900s to the 1930s. Now, obviously, not as many comic books at the time, but I have to give a nod to pulps, right? I've gotta recognize the influence the pulp magazines had on society. So if we think about it, pulp magazines really took on two different genres. Now there's a lot of fantasy and sci-fi, but they also tackled two specific areas. One was the idea of science and innovation. This was the idea of what was happening in the scientific community, and they were writing about this, and they were publishing about this to help communicate this. The other piece that I'm going to talk about in a minute is the idea of the hard-boiled detective. And what was happening with gangsters and things of that nature. Here we see in science and innovation this idea of 1920s mirror technology. So can we make a better mirror? If we look forward, we see the next one. We talk about the idea of amazing stories. We talk about the technology that we were chasing. But moreover, what we have to remember is this idea is we were publishing things that we were experiencing. So although this focus is on the future, right, this was right after, right during World War I. And so there was this fear, and there was this communication of what war is, what it's about, and all of a sudden we start to see it showing up in different places in this pulp magazine. Now, if we push forward and we move into, all of a sudden, the 1930s to the 1940s, you can see, right, a little bit of a hint of what was relevant to the world. We see the idea of the gangsters, we see the idea of, right, this hard-boiled detective in pulps and in comics. Now, this was resurrected in the 1950s, but the 1930s, this was incredibly relevant because you think about coming out of the Great Depression, you think of Al Capone, you think of all of these gangsters, and what you need to understand is many people didn't view them as criminals. They viewed them as heroes because in many situations, these individuals were giving back to the poor. They were helping those without. And so they were viewed almost as a Robin Hood. But it was also the idea that they had this fast, this romantic, this thrilling life, and it was being replicated oftentimes in the pages of these comics and the covers of these comics. Now, if we move forward and we look at it, there was something else that was happening in this time frame. I use this sequence of comics because we can see the first Speed comics. We can see the idea of working in the steel mill and the dangers of the steel mill. At the time, if you know anything about history, what was happening with Carnegie and Rockefeller and labor unions, and there's a lot of workers that were being exploited in dangerous situations. And we start to see that manifest in these comics. The other piece is all of a sudden here. Now, this is 1939, so this is before we entered World War II. However, at this time, Germany had invaded Poland, and everybody was starting to think about war again. World War I had ended in 1918, but all of a sudden now, this is starting to rise to the surface. Because if we look at the war machinery on the cover, this isn't World War II war machinery, this is from World War I. And now all of a sudden, this idea of war and the potential of what might happen is starting to emerge again. So if we move forward from there, we see our more traditional comics. And this is what many of us know. Our detectives, our actions, etc. But even here in the superhero titles, we can see snapshots of reality. We can see the fascination with automobiles and racing. We can see the idea of the magician. We see the gangsters that start to reappear in some of these pre-hero books. And even in the middle with Detective Comics 27, the first appearance of Batman, he was modeled, his original cape and cowl, which looks like wings, was modeled after Leonardo da Vinci's art of the perfect man. So even in the hero books, we started to see more of this become apparent. Now, most of us are more familiar with this era. Most of us are more familiar with the 1940s to the 1950s and what was happening at that time. Now, obviously, we know that at that time, we'd entered into World War II. Okay? We were gearing up for the war. We entered into the war after Pearl Harbor in 1941. If you're familiar with this at all, we know that Hitler had conquered most of Europe, pushed into Northern Africa, into Asia, and there was a lot of comics dedicated to this. Realistically, dedicated to the evils of Nazi Germany and Hitler. He wasn't being celebrated, he was the emperor of hate. And that's the message that we were trying to get out. So realistically, what we had is we had wartime propaganda where we could communicate to the youth and to other individuals how dangerous Hitler was. We see on the cover that Superman has Hitler, and I believe it's Hirohito. In the bottom, we see we have Mussolini as well as one of the pumpkins, because we were trying to communicate the dangers. Now, one of the reasons why is because what many people don't realize, at the advent of the war, the U.S. population was a very large percentage German, first generation German. I'm from Ohio, born and raised in Pittsburgh, and all of my heritage is German. If we go back to the 1940s, we had a very large contingent of individuals in the United States that were first-generation immigrants from Germany. The only group larger were the Italians. And what we need to understand is at the time of the war, Italy was divided. Part of Italy supported the Axis, part of Italy supported the Allies. So there was a fear in the United States that what are we going to do if all of a sudden this large group of Germans, for example, 70% in Wisconsin, decides that they want to support their German families. And so a lot of these comics were distributed heavily through the Midwest. Right? You go to towns like Milwaukee, Cleveland, you see so many of these war books simply because there was a fear of what's going to happen if people in our own country start to rise up. And so they started to use this as wartime propaganda, even here in the States. Now, we look at perhaps arguably one of the more famous comics, National 18, Reed Crandall cover, Will Eisner, Lou Fine interiors, and it talks about the war and attack on Pearl Harbor, and it was released before Pearl Harbor was attacked. So December is when Pearl Harbor was attacked, 1941. This actually says December. It came out a month to 6 weeks prior to that. But if we think about it, Will Eisner, Lou Fine were withdrawing this comic 3, 4, 5 months prior to the attack on Pearl Harbor. And in this comic, they're speculating on how the U.S. might be attacked, and this is one of the ways. So even before history happened, they were starting to draw and write about some of these different pieces. Now, if we move forward, we take a look at it, we have a group out there that many folks don't know existed called the Writers' War Board. And the Writers' War Board is a fascinating group of individuals, actresses, actors, celebrities, powerful individuals that formed a group that would make recommendations on stories to write about the war. Now, they were not paid. They had no official power, per se, because we didn't want to be viewed as fascists. We didn't want to be viewed as communists. But they would come up with stories, give them to the publishers to then publish. And the ultimate goal was they wanted to make sure that there was no such thing as a good Japanese person. That's how ingrained they were in this propaganda, right, moving forward. To the point where is that if an individual was actually portrayed as a monster and subhuman, then they frowned upon that because the goal was to instill fear. Now, we move past that, and obviously the war was over. We move into the next generation. We move into this next decade, the 1950s, 1960s, and here it gets interesting. Because now all of a sudden the publishers realize they have a platform to communicate because the World War II comics were so, so powerful. And all of a sudden World War II's over, but there's something else brewing. And we take a look at the next thing and we see, look upon the pictures of our giant cities, hundreds of years in the building smashed by the atom bomb, and say, this shall not come to pass. More than ever today, only a strong America can prevent this from becoming a reality. World War II's over, welcome in the Cold War. And so suddenly we transition to this idea of communism and what was happening in the Cold War, to the point where this became very popular in comic books. Here we see the Atomic War, we see the cover with the Chrysler Building, with the Empire State Building, right? 1950s, 1960s, depicting this destruction and what might happen. And again, the government started to use comic books as a mechanism to communicate. So many of you, if you're old enough, you're familiar with the Bay of Pigs invasion, the Cuban Missile Crisis, we know the communism in Cuba, and all of a sudden, the U.S. was trying to prevent this. And there was a fear that communism would spread throughout South America, Latin America. And so what the U.S. actually did is they created comic books in different languages. It was called Operation Mongoose. And distributed over 5 million comic books throughout South America, Latin America, talking about the dangers of communism. Because one of the challenges the U.S. had is when we published the World War II books, we distributed millions of them throughout Europe and the world. the Europeans saw these and found Americans to be sexist, racist, violent, all of the above. And so now the U.S. had to backtrack a little bit, and so they created these in the hopes that in different languages and speaking to people in their own language with their own cultural references could have an impact to prevent communism from spreading. Now we get to enter in Frederick Wortham, A Seduction of the Innocent. If you're familiar with this, as we move through the 1950s, he was a psychiatrist who came in and talked about the dangers of comic books. He talked about how they caused children to misbehave, to be violent delinquents, right? He had Senate hearings in front of the government, which created the Comic Book Code of Authority, which had the ability to censor comics because of the depictions of violence and all of these other things. So then all of a sudden, we see a genre of comics start to emerge that became very historical, very educational, and truly dedicated to helping to inform, to the point where many of these comics were now published for a very specific purpose beyond entertainment. We move past this and we start to see what's next. 1960s to 1970s. So, if we think about what's happening in the US at this time, we can start to understand the different movements, the different social issues that we're facing. And so the first one we're going to talk about briefly is the idea of civil rights in the U.S. So you see some of these snapshots of covers. We see, if you're familiar with the Lois Lane comic, I Am Curious Black, if you're familiar with the Black Panther series from the 1970s, they were trying to tackle racism and racial profiling. The 1970s. Because there were obviously challenges in the U.S. There was many, many things happening through the 60s and the 70s. And so in here, in the Black Panther comic, he's being followed through a grocery store, and he's attacked by the Ku Klux Klan. In the Lois Lane storyline, she's trying to interview African Americans, and they won't interview her. And so she needs to understand what it's like and the discrimination they feel. So for a day, she becomes an African American woman to experience what they're experiencing. All of this on the pages of comics. We start to look at some of these other ones, obviously, right, they don't all span the 1960s, but perhaps the most powerful one from 1957 is the Montgomery story. In the Montgomery story, it was a comic that was published about 250,000 copies and distributed to homes and neighborhoods, primarily poverty-stricken neighborhoods and minority neighborhoods that didn't know what was happening in the civil rights movement. And many individuals didn't have access to information, many couldn't read, so it was published in the Montgomery story and distributed. It's argued that this is the most impactful piece of literature in the civil rights movement, to the point that 17 households, not 17 people, but 17 households, with everybody in the household reading this comic book, or at least looking at the pictures to understand. It was so powerful that if you were caught in the Deep South with one of these issues, you could be lynched. That's how powerful this book was. Now, we move forward and we see what's next. We get in the 1970s to 1980s. Obviously, there's a little bit, the world's changing. We're starting to see more things. And one thing that we start to see is the idea of drugs. Now, drugs have always been around, but all of a sudden there was this new drug, heroin. Heroin was being introduced to the youth and the party scene throughout New York City and the rest of the country, and people were dying. They were using it, they were overdosing, and obviously there were huge implications. The U.S. government did not want to take on this issue. So what they did is, in 1971, the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare actually reached out to the comic book publishers and asked them if they would take on this issue. And so you can see, right, the Green Arrow, Green Lantern cover with Speedy, with a hypodermic needle, shooting up heroin. We see the Spider-Man storyline, the idea that somebody's overdosed on the cover. This is a direct reflection of what was happening exactly in society at that time. This wasn't meant for entertainment, this was meant for education. And the irony is, and this is the best part, the U.S. government asked them to do it, they agreed. The Comic Book Code of Authority said, no, you can't publish this. They said, but you ask us to. And they said, sorry, you can't. And they said, we're going to do it anyhow. And they did. Because the risks were so high, they thought that information had to get out there. So all of a sudden, we see a direct reflection of what's going on in society. Now, beyond this 1970s, there's a lot of other things happening. If you're familiar with Saturday Night Live, if you're a fan of Saturday Night Live, or Johnny Carson or David Letterman, all of a sudden we start to see them appear in the pages and the covers of comics, right? It became very popular. We started to see reality and fantasy and comics become much more entangled and intertwined. And it's to the point where if we move forward, we start to see this idea that even in Saturday Night Live on TV, they started to reflect more comic books. And where we start to see the superhero party, right? To the point where today, we even see more and more of this crossover between comics and real life and comics, vice versa. Now, if we move past this, right, we start to look a little bit, go backward. We start to look, one more. One thing that's interesting, and it didn't really fit a single era, was the idea of the representation of presidents in comics. Now, this is not a political conversation, so it's not like I'm saying, hey, be conservative, be liberal, be whatever. But what we see is that presidents started to become represented on the covers and the pages more and more. Here we see George Washington, we see Obama, we see Bush, Nixon, Abraham Lincoln arm wrestling. And what was interesting about it is even though they were represented in the pages of comics, they were represented as inferior because superheroes had the powers. They had the abilities. And the presidents were secondary. My friend Pete Monster has a Mystic Comics over there that has FDR on the cover, and he's actually in the back seat of the car being saved by Samson because he's just a mere man. He's a mere mortal without these powers and abilities. So we see all of these presidential and powerful figures being represented through the pages of comics and the covers of comics. Now, we fast forward and we move into the 1980s to today, and realistically, we see more and more and more representations of history. If you go to a comic book store today, and if you walk through the store, you will see 20, 30% of the books representing what's happening in society today. I grab this as just a screenshot. We look at it, and all of a sudden, obviously, O.J. Simpson, we know the O.J. Simpson story, that was replicated in comics. We know about the tragedy with Kurt Cobain, that was represented in comics. And I use the Bill Clinton because many of us know about Bill Clinton, his story as a president, right? To the point where Judge Dredd is actually, right, making him feel judge, jury, and executioner because of his behavior while he was in office. So we see these different things. Now, the last note that I want to end on, and I don't want to be a downer and I don't want to be negative, but arguably one of the things that had one of the biggest representations in recent history was 9/11. And we see many comic books. We see many comic books that were written that were dedicated to this, so that people could see, could be educated. Arguably, one of the most powerful and impactful ones was an Amazing Spider-Man 36, where we see this idea of, right, Spider-Man overlooking his city and the devastation that was done to his city, to the point where you open the splash page, and we see on the splash page, he's just overlooking the chaos that had occurred. And so now there are hundreds and hundreds of other books that I could bring into play and that I could talk about, but realistically, it's just a snapshot. Now, I don't want to end on that note, right? I'm going to bring it a little bit back close to home. As I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, I'm from Athens, Ohio, and one way that my city and my community has lived on forever in comic books is that Carrie Bates, some of you may be familiar with Carrie Bates, right? Writer and artist from Athens, Ohio, went to Ohio University. When he moved to New York City, he talked about Ohio University and how much he loved it. And everybody in New York City made fun of him because it's a Cal town, it's a Cal college. Nobody will ever hear about it, stop talking about it. So what Carey did is Carey actually wrote in Athens, Ohio, and he wrote in Ohio University into the comic book. He snuck it past the editor and he had it published so that his community, his town, would live on forever in the pages of comic books. Which I think is to take a few minutes today, share some of historical perspectives, how they've been represented in comics, and understand it's history is deep. There's a long tradition there. It's not just the World War II books. It goes back to the late 1800s and through every decade. History is represented on the pages of comic books. So the next time you look at a comic book, the next time you pick one up, the next time you read one, understand there may be some educational value to it beyond simply entertainment. Thank you.